Pantor Audio presents Hiroshima Diary, The Journal of a Japanese Physician, August 6th through September 30th, 1945. By Michihiko Hachiya, M.D. Translated and edited by Warner Wells, M.D. Narrated by Robertson Dean. Foreword to the 1995 edition. A half century has passed since Dr. Michihiko Hachiya wrote his diary in the ruins of Hiroshima. 40 years have gone by since his observations became available to English language listeners through the devoted translating and editing of an American doctor, Warner Wells. The translation was hailed as an extraordinary literary event when it first appeared in the United States in 1955, and it retains its capacity to move us today. This is a remarkable accomplishment, for what we encounter here is an account of the end of a ferocious war that is intimately Japanese and simultaneously transcends national, cultural, and racial boundaries. The diary speaks to the human heart and human condition, and does so without artifice, for it was not intended to be published. Dr. Hachiya himself was severely injured by the blast effects of the atomic bombing. At one point, he notes in passing that his face and body still showed around 150 scars. By August 8, 1945, however, 2 days after Hiroshima was devastated, he was well enough to begin keeping a record of his convalescence in the hospital he himself administered. That record is what we have here, and there is nothing comparable to it. As a rule, Westerners, and Americans in particular, have been reluctant to look closely at the world in which Dr. Hachiya lived between August 6th and the last day of September, when his diary ends. In the heroic American narrative of the war, the destruction of Hiroshima commonly ends with the mushroom cloud, followed by a quick fast-forward to Japan's surrender 9 days later. The Soviet declaration of war against Japan on August 8th receives little mention in this narrative. The dropping of a second atomic bomb on Nagasaki on August 9th is similarly neglected. The power of the Hiroshima bomb receives lavish, even loving attention. By contrast, commentary about the human consequences of the bombs on the largely civilian populations of Hiroshima and Nagasaki generally is shunned, for this undermines the heroic narrative and raises troubling questions about the good war. Episodically, almost in a cyclical manner, it is true that the American public has shown interest and sensitivity concerning what took place beneath the mushroom cloud. John Hersey's Hiroshima, a terse collection of portraits of atomic bomb victims, deeply affected many readers in 1946. Dr. Hachiya's Hiroshima Diary was seriously received in the mid-1950s, and over a decade later, the translation of the greatest Japanese account of death from radiation sickness, Masuji Ibuse's Black Rain, was hailed as a classic in the United States and Britain. In the early 1980s, the apocalyptic spectacle of nuclear death and devastation witnessed in Hiroshima and Nagasaki was transposed to the global level in an extraordinarily successful futuristic bestseller by Jonathan Schell, entitled The Fate of the Earth. The averted gaze has been the easier, more persistent response to Hiroshima and Nagasaki, however, and in mainstream U.S. circles, commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the end of World War II in Asia has strengthened this tendency. For understandable reasons, Americans wish to celebrate victory over an aggressive, fanatic, atrocious enemy. Most choose to see the atomic bombs as weapons that saved countless lives. In this heroic rendering, Hiroshima and Nagasaki simply hastened the end of a terrible global conflagration. These sentiments emerged strongly in the closing months of 1994 and opening months of 1995, when the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. was forced to drop plans for a major exhibition on the atomic bombs that would have included photographs and artifacts from Ground Zero. These were, critics declared, emotionally loaded. Intimate depiction of civilian Japanese victims, in the parlance of the heroic American narrative, they are casualties, it was argued, distorted the reality of a war in which the Japanese over and over again had victimized others atrociously. The chief historian of the U.S. Air Force publicly asked how the Smithsonian could have blundered so badly on such a morally unambiguous subject. The U.S. Senate unanimously approved a resolution condemning the institution for failing to celebrate the manner in which the atomic bombs had brought the war to a merciful end. In this highly charged emotional and ideological climate, the reissue of Dr. Hachiya's diary is a salutary event. His simple account tells us, as no one but the Japanese who experienced the bombs can, about the human consequences of nuclear weapons. It reminds us of the larger tragic narrative of World War II, in which heroism coexisted with moral ambiguity, and the same act could seem simultaneously merciful and merciless. From the Japanese perspective, Hiroshima and Nagasaki were not only an end, but also a beginning. The beginning of grotesque, lingering deaths, lifelong bereavement, unprecedented physical harm from radiation, and ceaseless psychological trauma, of course, but also the beginning of a new sense of the preciousness of life. Shuffling through the filth and debris of his ruined, overcrowded hospital, watching patients and acquaintances die, often mysteriously, assailed by the stench of bodies being cremated wafting through the hospital's shattered windows, through all this, Dr. Hachiya moved with composure, compassion, and keen appreciation of the smallest pleasures of so-called normal life. To turn a chronicle of nuclear horror into an affirmation of life in this manner is no small accomplishment, and the triumph of Dr. Hachiya's Hiroshima Diary lies in his ability to do this so naturally, without preaching, usually without philosophizing, just by being himself and setting down his daily thoughts and activities. That his thoughts and feelings are entirely accessible to non-Japanese, despite numerous small references to things peculiar to everyday Japanese culture, is the ultimate measure of his triumph. Somehow, in August 1945, when the rhetoric of war hate and race hate was at fever pitch and the most devastating weapon in history had just shattered his life, this modest and conspicuously patriotic physician managed to express himself almost entirely in the language of a common humanity. These matters bear spelling out a bit, for as the cyclical nature of American memory suggests, they are easily forgotten. Of course, the images of nuclear hell that Dr. Hachiya depicts may in the end remain most indelibly etched in many readers' minds. In this regard, his chronicle is typical of other hibakusha, or survivor accounts, where the same haunting images of nuclear destruction appear. The stunning flash, pika, of the bomb, followed by a colossal blast, don, that shattered buildings kilometers away. Nakedness or semi-nakedness from the blast stripping clothing away. Eerie silence. People walking in lines with their hands outstretched and skin peeling off, like automatons, dreamwalkers, scarecrows, a line of ants. Corpses frozen by death while in the full action of flight. A dead man on a bicycle. A burned and blinded horse. Youngsters huddled together awaiting death. Mothers with dead children. Infants with dying mothers. Corpses without faces. Water everywhere. In firefighting cisterns, swimming pools, the rivers that fed the city, clogged with dead bodies. Fires like the infernos of hell. A man holding his eyeball in his hand. Survivors in crowded, ruined buildings, lying in vomit, urine, and feces. Everywhere flies and maggots. This is the familiar iconography of the immediate aftermath of the atomic bombing, although at this early date, Dr. Hachiya, largely cut off from the outside world, was simply recording what he saw or others told him. Some of his descriptions are unusually vivid. A visitor comments about how roasted corpses become smaller. Burned people smell like drying squid or look like boiled octopuses. The odor of bodies being cremated is likened to that of burning sardines. In perhaps the most haunting of all the diary's images, as Dr. Hachiya makes his daily rounds, we frequently encounter a nameless, beautiful girl. She is always identified simply as the beautiful girl, who has been severely burned everywhere except her face. In early entries, she lies in a puddle of old blood and pus, soiled with urine and excrement. As time passes, she is able to smile when the doctor visits. By the end of the diary, she can stand and go to the toilet by herself. What became of her? We will never know. Because he is a physician, Dr. Hachiya quickly moves, and the reader with him, to the next level of the nuclear trauma, the emergence of inexplicable symptoms and unanticipated deaths. Patients who seem to be improving suddenly worsen and die. People who appeared to have escaped harm entirely are stricken. They become speckled with subcutaneous bleeding, their hair falls out, and they have bloody diarrhea, vomit blood, pass blood from their genitals and rectum. Autopsies reveal massive internal hemorrhages that are erratic but seem to affect every organ. Belated acquisition of a microscope shows alarmingly low white blood cell counts, as well as the destruction of platelets in the blood. Could this have something to do with the bomb changing atmospheric pressure? Could it be a poison gas? In the course of these weeks, Dr. Hachiya himself helps identify the mysterious scourge as radiation sickness and determines that all of the patients dying in this manner were within 1 kilometer of the bomb's hypocenter. The intellectual satisfaction of understanding these deaths is part of Dr. Hachiya's own coming alive again, and he does not disguise the pleasure he takes in helping clarify this dreadful riddle. As early as August 9th, he records the delight he feels in finding that his scientific curiosity is returning. Scientific understanding does not eliminate the horror, he indicates throughout, but it can mitigate the terror of the unknown and help dampen irrational fears. Help dispel, for example, the rumor that Hiroshima would be uninhabitable for 75 years. Those dying of radiation sickness, he takes pains to explain publicly, were exposed to the pica. What the diary does not reveal, for it stops too soon, is the appalling fact that from late 1945 until 1952, Japanese medical researchers were prohibited by U.S. occupation authorities from publishing scientific articles on the effects of the atomic bombs. Even in these earliest grim days after the bomb was dropped, Dr. Hachiya emerges as remarkably frank. Within 2 days, he regretfully observes how quickly he and his colleagues had come to accept massive death and cease to respect its awfulness. In time, the smell of cremations outside the window does not even disturb people's appetites. In one of his most stunning entries, he dryly records, on August 11th, how the rumor spread within his miserably crowded hospital that Japan possessed the same weapon that had devastated Hiroshima and Nagasaki and had retaliated against the west coast of the United States. The whole atmosphere in the ward changed, and those patients who were most severely hurt were happiest. People sang songs of victory. They were convinced the tide of the war had changed. In all the literature about the bombs, there are few scenes more Dickensian than this. To historians of these days and weeks, Dr. Hachiya's response to the Emperor's surrender broadcast on August 15th also is of considerable interest. Like many of his country folk, he had expected to be urged to fight to the end and was stunned to hear that Japan had capitulated. The shock of surrender, he writes, was even greater than the shock of the atomic bombing. He was overwhelmed with despair. Here and frequently afterward, in language redolent of the emperor worship under which the Japanese were marshaled for war, he reiterates his veneration of the throne and deep concern about the emperor's personal well-being. If there is a second Dickensian vignette in the diary, it is surely the scene in which Dr. Hachiya admiringly records how acquaintances of his stumbled through the dead and dying to bring the emperor's sacred photograph from the hospital to a safer place. Such a response to the surrender was commonplace, but not ubiquitous in Japan at this time. Many other Japanese greeted the capitulation with tears of relief, some even celebrated. But the obverse side of Dr. Hachiya's emperor worship was indeed widespread, namely, contempt for Japan's military leaders. With characteristic frankness, Dr. Hachiya acknowledges that hitherto he had been sympathetic toward the military. Now he despises them, for they had betrayed the emperor and deceived the people. This was a widespread sentiment in Japan in the months and years following the defeat. While Emperor Hirohito, by and large, was exonerated from responsibility for war and defeat, his generals and admirals were widely condemned as having been ruthless, duplicitous, and stupid. With but one exception, Dr. Hachiya never openly expresses hatred in the diary. The exception is not, as might be expected, toward the Americans who dropped the atomic bombs, but rather toward General Hideki Tojo and the Imperial Army, whose arrogant and unbounded stupidity brought disgrace and disaster upon their country. Obliquely, too, the diary conveys these same sentiments. When Dr. Hachiya writes about digging in the rubble left by the atomic bomb and finding wooden bullets and broken bamboo spears, he knows full well what an absurd juxtaposition he is recording. And when, early in September, he prepares a report on the bomb effects for a newspaper and declares that the Japanese were defeated in a scientific war, once again he is offering an observation that was widespread at the time and implicitly critical of Japan's irrational wartime leaders. The ramifications of such attitudes were far-reaching. Although Dr. Hachiya and his little community were cut off from newspapers and radio for many weeks, their observations resonated strongly with what Japanese throughout the defeated country were saying. The angry exclamation that Tojo deserved to die for his transgressions, for example, was reified in the form of widespread popular indifference to the fate of Japanese leaders in the Tokyo war crimes trials in subsequent years. More generally, this immediate contempt for the folly of the military leadership that led Japan to disastrous defeat survived in the post-war political culture in the form of deep anti-military and even pacifist sentiments. On the other hand, unbeknownst to Dr. Hachiya, the profound respect for science that emerges in his diary also was being widely trumpeted throughout Japan in these very same days as a force to be developed in reconstructing a peaceful Japan. The contempt for the military that emerges so strongly in Hiroshima Diary did not extend to the victorious Americans. This seems astonishing, given the direct suffering all the figures who appear in the diary had experienced from the Hiroshima bombing. In fact, this too was a fairly common response to the defeat throughout Japan. Initially, there was widespread apprehension about how the conquerors would behave when they occupied the country. Soon, however, this gave way to awkward but remarkably amicable relations. In the cataclysmic moment of staggering defeat, the evil enemy for most Japanese became Japan's own military. Throughout Japan, even ordinary demobilized servicemen often were treated with contempt or plain derision. When word of the impending arrival of occupation forces in Hiroshima reached Dr. Hachiya's hospital, the initial response was typical. Many local women, including even some patients, fled out of fear that they might be raped. Dr. Hachiya's personal response, however, was remarkably composed. "I felt we had nothing to worry about," he recorded on September 13th, "because Westerners were a cultured people, not given to pilfering and marauding." His initial encounter with an American officer soon after he made this comment was strained, but was quickly followed by a conspicuously positive evaluation of the young Americans who came to his hospital. They were, in his estimation, warm, friendly, kind, and amusing. They were gentlemen. They impressed him as citizens of a great country. This ability of antagonists on both sides of the atrocious Japanese-American war to move so abruptly from bitter hostility to cordial relationships has often been commented on and puzzled over. Dr. Hachiya's journal offers a subtle perspective on this turn from enmity to amity, in which, once again, Japanese behavior is contrasted unfavorably to that of the victorious Anglo-Americans. When one of his medical colleagues rushes to the hospital to urge him to evacuate the women because Americans were coming, for example, Dr. Hachiya jots down a telling aside. His colleague was so agitated, he observes, because of his awareness of how Japan's own soldiers had conducted themselves in China. Such initial fears about American rapacity by many Japanese, especially males, that is, in considerable part was a projection based on painful knowledge of how badly the Japanese themselves had behaved in alien and occupied lands. It is rare in Japanese writings from this time to see this submerged line of thinking exposed so incisively. And when the arriving Allied conquerors did in fact generally behave with restraint and even generosity toward the local population, the favorable impression of the victors was strengthened. Where the contemporary scene in defeated Japan is concerned, the diary offers vivid testimony to two particularly debilitating aspects of the post-surrender scene that similarly were not peculiar to Hiroshima or Nagasaki, but rather persisted throughout the country. One was the condition widely known as kyodatsu, an overall state of demoralization and psychological prostration. The despair and confusion that Dr. Hachiya witnessed on his brief forays outside the hospital certainly reflected the staggering trauma of the nuclear devastation. They were, however, scenes repeated to greater or lesser degrees everywhere. Thus, the panorama around Hiroshima Station that Dr. Hachiya describes on September 15th, exactly a month after the Emperor's surrender broadcast, is a scene that could have been duplicated in countless other Japanese towns and cities. Tired war victims, demobilized soldiers, old people leaning against the burnt pillars, people walking aimlessly, heedless of all around them, and beggars. These, Dr. Hachiya comments, were the real conquerors. His stunning image on the same day of a poor woman walking through the rubble wearing her wedding kimono and carrying a sack of sweet potatoes could stand as an emblematic symbol of the kyodatsu condition that shrouded the entire country in these days. In this milieu of exhaustion and despair, venality and corruption flourished like rank weeds. On this matter, too, the diary is a valuable intimate source. For time and again, as the days pass, Dr. Hachiya records his mounting dismay at Japanese behavior in the wake of catastrophic defeat. Drunken ex-soldiers ride the trolley. Looting and burglary are widespread. Local officials are mostly inept and corrupt, and massive pillaging of military supplies is taking place. Inflation has made money almost meaningless. People with evil faces and foul tongues suddenly appear on the scene, profiting from others' misery. Disreputable men fondle uncouth girls. Greed rules the day. Evil influences are everywhere. The country appears to have fallen into the clutches of the mean and unintelligent. Hiroshima, the doctor notes, when supplies are even stolen from his hospital, was becoming a wicked town. This, too, was a widespread phenomenon in immediate post-surrender Japan, particularly in the weeks that elapsed between the surrender and the actual arrival of Allied occupation authorities and their belated consolidation of authority. Indeed, in the country at large, during the 8 weeks covered by Hiroshima Diary, military authorities, as well as politicians and businessmen at both the national and local levels, spent a major portion of their time destroying records and looting the massive storehouses of military material that had been stockpiled in anticipation of prolonged war and a last-ditch defense of the home islands. Like his striking vignettes of the kyodatsu condition of exhaustion and despair, Dr. Hachiya's terse observations of corruption and venality open a window not simply on the local scene in Hiroshima after the bomb, but, really unknown to him at the time, on Japan as a whole. It is in this broader milieu of internal degradation, coupled with staggering defeat, that the conquering Americans emerge as unexpectedly positive figures. Even old Mrs. Saiki, a quiet figure of strength and comfort throughout the diary, whose daughter-in-law and three sons all had been killed, concludes after friendly young American officers visit the hospital that America-san is kind. I think they are very nice. This is an astonishing comment, and yet, in the extraordinary environment that Dr. Hachiya portrays, it does not really surprise us. In various ways, Dr. Hachiya's deceptively simple account of the Hiroshima bombing and its aftermath thus reveals a world of many layers of complexity. His diary is not merely an unusually intimate record of nuclear death and destruction. It is now clearer in retrospect that it also provides an unusually broad window on the psychology and social pathology of defeat. Beyond all this, however, and this is what ultimately gives Hiroshima Diary its enduring quality, it is a chronicle about coming alive, about cherishing life after tasting the bitterest kinds of death. On several occasions, Dr. Hachiya makes clear that he was as passionate a patriot as anyone, ready to throw down his life and die for the country if and when the emperor called on him to do so. At one point, he quotes with understanding and even approval a fanatic fight-to-the-bitter-end entry from the diary of a close friend whose young son has just been killed in the bombing. But the destruction of Hiroshima, the loss of all his possessions, the near loss of his own life, the daily spectacle of war-wrought misery and death in the hospital, all lead Dr. Hachiya and many around him to repudiate ultranationalism and war, and linger instead on the preciousness of personal relationships and private blessings. Tucked away in the diary, sometimes almost as passing thoughts, are lines that speak more or less directly to this. "How hard for a man to die," Dr. Hachiya muses while lying in bed 8 days after the bomb, "whose life has once before been miraculously spared. On the day of the pika, I gave no thought to my life, but today I wanted to live, and death became a spectacle of terror." 3 weeks later, he reflects again on how precious small things are, thoughts sparked, in this instance, by the destruction of an old plaque with calligraphy quoting words of wisdom from the Chinese classics. "When I was filled with faith in the certainty of victory, and when I was working with thoughts only for the emperor," he confides on this occasion, "nothing was precious. It seemed entirely appropriate to sacrifice everything for the country. Now, however, things had changed. Since the pika, we had all become desperate, and our fight was the fight of defeat, even if we had to fight on stones. Our homes and our precious family possessions were no longer meaningless, but now they were gone. I felt lonesome and alone, because I no longer had even a home." Old Mrs. Saiki, widowed and bereft of all her children, expresses similar sentiments when recounting where she was when the bomb fell. "All was darkness," she recalls, "and she thought she had died. What a joy to find she was still alive." This is the sentiment that keeps Dr. Hachiya's small group in the hospital going, and it is indeed the sentiment that ennobles the greatest Japanese writings on the atomic bomb experience, such as Ibusei's Black Rain. The overwhelming horror of man-made death is countered, placed in perspective, and ultimately transcended by evocation of the simplest activities of human intercourse and normal daily life, or, as in Ibusei's chronologically longer account, by the nurturing, cyclical rhythms of nature. This healing process, this transcendence through the seemingly plainest of activities, occurs over and over again in the diary. Dr. Hachiya never moves away from the dead and dying, but he simultaneously creates an alternative, life-affirming world by recognizing the wonder of what in other circumstances would be taken for granted. Fruit and vegetables become treasures. Someone brings peaches, and on another day there are tomatoes or grapes. One day, the ragged contingent in the ruined hospital room dines on the river fish ayu. Obtaining sugar is a cause for celebration. Cigarettes bring near ecstasy. Baths are recorded, and so is the happy discovery of a clean and intact toilet. Restoration of electricity is a signal event, as is the first arrival of mail and the first newspaper. A good bowel movement is deeply satisfying. This was no small matter when others were passing blood, an ominous sign of the radiation sickness. Still, the small group in the hospital managed to buoy their spirits with seemingly endless repartee involving toilet jokes. In Japan as a whole, the broader social and cultural literature of these weeks and months reveals similar preoccupations. There they are linked to what in the Japanese idiom would be called transcending kyodatsu, that is, moving beyond the immediate trauma of the defeat, taking heart, regaining hope, recovering a taste for life. This was all a familiar part of becoming psychologically whole again. And what this ultimately involved was a restoration of personal connections and pursuits that the war had all but obliterated. From this perspective, and Hiroshima Diary is a representative example of this way of thinking, the atomic bombs were the ultimate symbol of the horror of war itself. In the Japanese context, this meant that they were simultaneously a symbol of the folly of superpatriotism as well as the fatuousness of those who sought to mobilize people for military crusades in the name of the state. In this sense, Dr. Hachiya's chronicle also can be read as an account of returning to an essentially private world, a world of intensely human and personal connections. Friendship is cherished, so are family relations. Every individual life is precious. Work, in this instance scientific and medical work, is redemptive. One works to heal, to construct, and not to harm. One thinks of the former enemy not in terms of past horrors, but rather terms of personal acquaintance, and later, professional collaboration. There is both modesty and great dignity here, and of course pathos, because now, a half century later, we know things Dr. Hachiya could not anticipate. The richness of his deceptively simple chronicle is such that each listener surely will come away with different lasting impressions, different moments or images that stay in the mind. I find myself thinking of one such moment, when, on the last day of August, old Mrs. Saiki chides Dr. Hachiya for working so long at his microscope, trying to understand the strange and terrible symptoms that radiation sickness has caused in his patients. He has forgotten to eat lunch, she reminds him, and smoked too much, and is harming his body. This is the passage. Baba-san, I answered softly, we now understand some of the things which puzzled us before. Is that so? She retorted. Will you be able to cure the disease now? We know, of course, that the answer was no. What the atomic bomb did could never be undone. Our only hope is to face it squarely and learn from Hiroshima. John W. Dower, March 28, 1995. Foreword. The bombing of Hiroshima marked a new era in man's growing skill in the art of self-destruction. During the saturation bombing of Germany and Japan in World War II, cities were destroyed, but the destruction was segmental, requiring days or weeks, so that city dwellers had some chance to flee or find shelter. Moreover, those who were killed or injured had the comfort of knowing that they were being killed by more or less familiar and acceptable weapons. But at Hiroshima, on the bright, clear morning of August 6, 1945, thousands were killed, more thousands were fatally injured, and the homes of 250,000 people were destroyed within seconds of the falling of a single bomb. Since that day, terrifying progress in the technology of nuclear warfare and the appalling knowledge that indulgence in atomic weapons may permanently impair the biological future of the human race have combined to emphasize the fact that Hiroshima presented mankind with a fateful choice. Perhaps it was some sense of this that led me in 1950 to accept an offer to become a surgical consultant to the Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission. It was a position that I held for 2.5 years. The commission, operating in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, had been formed to discover if there were delayed effects of the atom bombs dropped on these cities in 1945. Since most of my work was outside the commission's headquarters, in Japanese hospitals and clinics, I came to know and admire the Japanese medical profession and became acquainted with their patients. It was only natural, therefore, to want to know what the people, as people and not as medical case histories, experienced after the atom bombs were dropped. By a stroke of good fortune, I learned that Dr. Hachiya, director of the Hiroshima Communications Hospital, had written a diary of his experiences as a patient and bedridden hospital director. I also learned that, with some misgivings as to the likelihood of renewing painful memories, he had been persuaded by friends who saw its value as a historical document to publish the diary. It appeared serially in the Teishi Nigaku, a small medical journal circulated among the medical employees of the Japanese Communications Ministry. On an overcast, bone-chilling afternoon in the early spring of 1951, I met Dr. Hachiya in his hospital reception room and, over warming cups of hot green tea, asked his permission to examine his diary with the view of having it translated and published in English. Dr. Hachiya graciously consented and placed at my disposal his manuscript copy and reprints of the medical journal. I do not know at what point I decided to supervise the translation and do the editing myself. I know I felt it as a very personal responsibility. I cannot read Japanese except in tedious and laborious fashion, with complete dependence on dictionaries and grammars. This almost insurmountable handicap I was able to overcome by the assistance of Dr. Neil Tsukifuji, a brilliant young Japanese doctor born in Los Angeles and educated in America and Japan, who worked with me as assistant and interpreter. During our spare time for the next year, on weekends, holidays, and evenings, we rendered the diary into crude English. When there was any question regarding the meaning of a word, phrase, or sentence, we consulted Dr. Hachiya, so the translation could be as accurate as possible and preserve the Japanese idiom. We met and talked with many of the people mentioned in the diary, and with Dr. Hachiya visited all of the places he describes. Trying to relive Dr. Hachiya's experience, I succeeded to the extent that I came to dream of the bombing and on occasion awakened in terror. Japanese, like other Oriental languages, has a dignity, a subtlety, and a beauty that make it extremely difficult to render into English. It can be done, however, as evidenced by the magnificent prose of Lafcadio Hearn. Perhaps because I chose him as a model, I have spent the last 3 years revising and editing the original rough translation, in the hope I could preserve the balance, simplicity, and quality of values Dr. Hachiya achieved in his own tongue. I have tried to limit the apparatus of the translation to the essential. I have retained the metric system used in Japan for all measurement, except that I have changed longer distances into miles and centigrade temperature readings into Fahrenheit. All of us will be repaid beyond measure if this diary helps to refresh our memories, stimulate our imaginations, and temper our thinking about war, and especially the horror of atomic war. For if we cannot enliven our humanity, we are doomed. Warner Wells, March 15, 1955. The Place and the People. Since Dr. Hachiya began his diary with no thought that it might be published, he saw no need to describe either the hospital that was its setting or the members of the staff who were the principal characters. The Hiroshima Communications Hospital served the employees in the Hiroshima area of the Ministry of Communications, which in Japan controls postal, telegraph, and telephone service. Since Hiroshima was a city of 500,000 population and the capital of the prefecture of Hiroshima, with over 2 million population, the hospital was an institution of considerable importance. It had approximately 20 on its staff and 125 beds. This latter figure does not give a proper sense of the scale of its operations, since outpatient service in Japan, as in America, is frequently greater than inpatient service. The hospital adjoined the main office of the Communications Bureau, and both were of strong, reinforced concrete construction. After the bombing, the Bureau became an annex to the hospital. Both were located about 1,500 meters from the hypocenter of the bomb, on the northeast border of a large military area, the Hiroshima Military Barracks, which was totally destroyed. Dr. Hachiya's home was a few hundred meters from the hospital. Hiroshima had not been bombed during the current war, but in anticipation of a raid, the military authorities, a few months before, had demolished thousands of houses to make fire lanes and had evacuated much of its personnel. Following this, on his own authority, Dr. Hachiya had evacuated his inpatients to the interior, so that at the time of the bombing, the hospital was practically empty. 6 August, 1945. The hour was early, the morning still, warm and beautiful. Shimmering leaves, reflecting sunlight from a cloudless sky, made a pleasant contrast with shadows in my garden as I gazed absently through wide-flung doors opening to the south. Clad in drawers and undershirt, I was sprawled on the living room floor, exhausted because I had just spent a sleepless night on duty as an air warden in my hospital. Suddenly, a strong flash of light startled me, and then another. So well does one recall little things that I remember vividly how a stone lantern in the garden became brilliantly lit, and I debated whether this light was caused by a magnesium flare or sparks from a passing trolley. Garden shadows disappeared. The view where a moment before all had been so bright and sunny was now dark and hazy. Through swirling dust, I could barely discern a wooden column that had supported one corner of my house. It was leaning crazily, and the roof sagged dangerously. Moving instinctively, I tried to escape, but rubble and fallen timbers barred the way. By picking my way cautiously, I managed to reach the roca and step down into my garden. A profound weakness overcame me, so I stopped to regain my strength. To my surprise, I discovered that I was completely naked. How odd! Where were my drawers and undershirt? What had happened? All over the right side of my body, I was cut and bleeding. A large splinter was protruding from a mangled wound in my thigh, and something warm trickled into my mouth. My cheek was torn, I discovered, as I felt it gingerly, with the lower lip laid wide open. Embedded in my neck was a sizable fragment of glass, which I matter-of-factly dislodged, and with the detachment of one stunned and shocked, I studied it and my blood-stained hand. Where was my wife? Suddenly, thoroughly alarmed, I began to yell for her.
Yaeko-san! Yaeko-san! Where are you?
Blood began to spurt. Had my carotid artery been cut? Would I bleed to death? Frightened and irrational, I called out again.
It's a 500-ton bomb! Yaeko-san, where are you? A 500-ton bomb has fallen!
Yaeko-san, pale and frightened, her clothes torn and bloodstained, emerged from the ruins of our house, holding her elbow. Seeing her, I was reassured. My own panic assuaged, I tried to reassure her.
We'll be all right, I exclaimed. Only let's get out of here as fast as we can.
She nodded, and I motioned for her to follow me. The shortest path to the street lay through the house next door, so through the house we went, running, stumbling, falling, and then running again, until in headlong flight we tripped over something and fell sprawling into the street. Getting to my feet, I discovered that I had tripped over a man's head.
Excuse me, please!
I cried hysterically. There was no answer. The man was dead. The head had belonged to a young officer whose body was crushed beneath a massive gate. We stood in the street, uncertain and afraid, until a house across from us began to sway, and then, with a rending motion, fell almost at our feet. Our own house began to sway, and in a minute it too collapsed in a cloud of dust. Other buildings caved in or toppled. Fires sprang up, and, whipped by a vicious wind, began to spread. It finally dawned on us that we could not stay there in the street, so we turned our steps towards the hospital. Our home was gone, which was only a few hundred meters from the hospital. We were wounded and needed treatment, and after all, it was my duty to be with my staff. This latter was an irrational thought. What good could I be to anyone, hurt as I was? We started out, but after 20 or 30 steps, I had to stop. My breath became short, my heart pounded, and my legs gave way under me. An overpowering thirst seized me, and I begged Gaeko-san to find me some water. But there was no water to be found. After a little, my strength somewhat returned, and we were able to go on. I was still naked, and although I did not feel the least bit of shame, I was disturbed to realize that modesty had deserted me. On rounding a corner, we came upon a soldier standing idly in the street. He had a towel draped across his shoulder, and I asked if he would give it to me to cover my nakedness. The soldier surrendered the towel quite willingly, but said not a word. A little later I lost the towel, and Yaeko-san took off her apron and tied it around my loins. Our progress towards the hospital was interminably slow, until finally my legs, stiff from drying blood, refused to carry me farther. The strength, even the will, to go on deserted me. So I told my wife, who was almost as badly hurt as I, to go on alone. This she objected to, but there was no choice. She had to go ahead and try to find someone to come back for me. Yaeko-san looked into my face for a moment, and then, without saying a word, turned away and began running towards the hospital. Once she looked back and waved, and in a moment she was swallowed up in the gloom. It was quite dark now, and with my wife gone, a feeling of dreadful loneliness overcame me. I must have gone out of my head lying there in the road, because the next thing I recall was discovering that the clot on my thigh had been dislodged and blood was again spurting from the wound. I pressed my hand to the bleeding area, and after a while the bleeding stopped and I felt better. Could I go on? I tried. It was all a nightmare. My wounds, the darkness, the road ahead. My movements were ever so slow. Only my mind was running at top speed. In time, I came to an open space where the houses had been removed to make a fire lane. Through the dim light, I could make out ahead of me the hazy outlines of the Communication Bureau's big concrete building, and beyond it, the hospital. My spirits rose, because I knew that now someone would find me, and if I should die, at least my body would be found. I paused to rest. Gradually, things around me came into focus. There were the shadowy forms of people, some of whom looked like walking ghosts. Others moved as though in pain, like scarecrows, their arms held out from their bodies with forearms and hands dangling. These people puzzled me until I suddenly realized that they had been burned and were holding their arms out to prevent the painful friction of raw surfaces rubbing together. A naked woman carrying a naked baby came into view. I averted my gaze. Perhaps they had been in the bath. But then I saw a naked man, and it occurred to me that, like myself, some strange thing had deprived them of their clothes. An old woman lay near me with an expression of suffering on her face, but she made no sound. Indeed, one thing was common to everyone I saw: complete silence. All who could were moving in the direction of the hospital. I joined in the dismal parade when my strength was somewhat recovered, and at last reached the gates of the Communications Bureau. Familiar surroundings, familiar faces. There was Mr. Iguchi and Mr. Yoshihiro, and my old friend Mr. Sera, the head of the business office. They hastened to give me a hand, their expressions of pleasure changing to alarm when they saw that I was hurt. I was too happy to see them to share their concern. No time was lost over greetings. They eased me onto a stretcher and carried me into the communications building, ignoring my protests that I could walk. Later, I learned that the hospital was so overrun that the Communications Bureau had to be used as an emergency hospital. The rooms and corridors were crowded with people, many of whom I recognized as neighbors. To me, it seemed that the whole community was there. My friends passed me through an open window into a janitor's room, recently converted to an emergency first aid station. The room was a shambles. Fallen plaster, broken furniture, and debris littered the floor, the walls were cracked, and a heavy steel window casement was twisted and almost wrenched from its seating. What a place to dress the wounds of the injured. To my great surprise, who should appear but my private nurse, Miss Kado, and Mr. Mizoguchi, and old Mrs. Saiki. Miss Kado set about examining my wounds without speaking a word. No one spoke. I asked for a shirt and pajamas. They got them for me, but still no one spoke. Why was everyone so quiet? Miss Kado finished the examination, and in a moment it felt as if my chest was on fire. She had begun to paint my wounds with iodine, and no amount of entreaty would make her stop. With no alternative but to endure the iodine, I tried to divert myself by looking out the window. The hospital lay directly opposite, with part of the roof and the third-floor sunroom in plain view, and as I looked up, I witnessed a sight which made me forget my smarting wounds. Smoke was pouring out of the sunroom windows. The hospital was afire.
"Fire!"
I shouted.
"Fire! Fire! The hospital is on fire!"
My friends looked up. It was true. The hospital was on fire. The alarm was given, and from all sides people took up the cry. The high-pitched voice of Mr. Sera, the business officer, rose above the others, and it seemed as if his was the first voice I had heard that day. The uncanny stillness was broken. Our little world was now in pandemonium. I remember that Dr. Sasada, chief of the pediatric service, came in and tried to reassure me, but I could scarcely hear him above the din. I heard Dr. Hinoi's voice, and then Dr. Koyama's. Both were shouting orders to evacuate the hospital, and with such vigor that it sounded as though the sheer strength of their voices could hasten those who were slow to obey. The sky became bright as flames from the hospital mounted. Soon the bureau was threatened, and Mr. Sera gave the order to evacuate. My stretcher was moved into a rear garden and placed beneath an old cherry tree. Other patients limped into the garden or were carried, until soon the entire area became so crowded that only the very ill had room to lie down. No one talked, and the ominous silence was relieved only by a subdued rustle among so many people, restless, in pain, anxious, and afraid, waiting for something else to happen. The sky filled with black smoke and glowing sparks. Flames rose, and the heat set currents of air in motion. Updrafts became so violent that sheets of zinc roofing were hurled aloft and released, humming and twirling in erratic flight. Pieces of flaming wood soared and fell like fiery swallows. While I was trying to beat out the flames, a hot ember seared my ankle. It was all I could do to keep from being burned alive. The bureau started to burn, and window after window became a square of flame until the whole structure was converted into a crackling, hissing inferno. Scorching winds howled around us, whipping dust and ashes into our eyes and up our noses. Our mouths became dry, our throats raw and sore from the biting smoke pulled into our lungs. Coughing was uncontrollable. We would have moved back, but a group of wooden barracks behind us caught fire and began to burn like tinder. The heat finally became too intense to endure, and we were left no choice but to abandon the garden. Those who could fled. Those who could not perished. Had it not been for my devoted friends, I would have died, but again they came to the rescue and carried my stretcher to the main gate on the other side of the bureau. Here, a small group of people were already clustered, and here I found my wife. Dr. Sasada and Miss Kato joined us. Fires sprang up on every side as violent winds fanned flames from one building to another. Soon, we were surrounded. The ground we held in front of the Communications Bureau became an oasis in a desert of fire. As the flames came closer, the heat became more intense, and if someone in our group had not had the presence of mind to drench us with water from a fire hose, I doubt if anyone could have survived. Since the water mains entered the city from the north, and since the Communications Bureau was in the northern edge of the city, its water supply was not destroyed. Hot as it was, I began to shiver. The drenching was too much. My heart pounded. Things began to whirl until all before me blurred.
Kurushii,
I murmured weakly.
I am done.
The sound of voices reached my ears as though from a great distance and finally became louder, as if close at hand. I opened my eyes. Dr. Sasada was feeling my pulse. What had happened? Miss Kato gave me an injection. My strength gradually returned. I must have fainted. Huge raindrops began to fall. Some thought a thunderstorm was beginning and would extinguish the fires. But these drops were capricious. A few fell, and then a few more, and that was all the rain we saw. There were many reports of scanty rainfall over the city after the bombing. The drops were described as large and dirty, and some claimed that they were laden with radioactive dust. The first floor of the bureau was now ablaze, and flames were spreading rapidly towards our little oasis by the gate. Right then, I could hardly understand the situation, much less do anything about it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.